All That Stuff on BCTV is supported by the Renaissance Auction Group.
And welcome to the February 2023 episode of All That Stuff. We've got 61 slides tonight. That would be our record, just like Roger Maris. That would be our record if we get through all 61 slides, so we're not going to waste a whole lot of time. Let's go straight to our two introductory slides if we can. I am Bill Howze. I am the producer and host of All That Stuff. I'm also the owner and principal auctioneer of the Renaissance Auction Group and a personal property appraiser of about 43 years now. Oh, I hate to even say that. All right, what are we going to talk about tonight? Auctions. Variety is the spice of life. All right, so we have this big consignment auction coming up. And, you know, I was, I've always thought about this, you know, for 20, 25, 30 years, what do you think people think when they come from some other country and they walk into like one of our grocery stores, right? Well, I just happened to be reading an article in The Atlantic that actually what I assumed that people coming from other places where the marketing of food is different and where maybe, you know, they don't even have marketing of food, maybe they're growing their own food, maybe it's all produced, they would walk into one of our grocery stores and say, wow. So I was reading this article, and what I discovered was that in 1977, when Queen Elizabeth came to visit the United States, one of the places she went was a giant food store in Washington, D.C. It's a different giant chain than we have, the one that serves the Washington, D.C. area. And when Boris Yeltsin came to the United States, one place he wanted to go was a grocery store, a modern grocery store. And according to this article, when Boris Yeltsin saw the American version of grocery stores, he said later on in his memoirs that at that moment he knew that communism had failed. You know, because back home there were all the empty shelves, he realized that free enterprise and capitalism was the way to go. That's what they said in the article. So I got to thinking, you know, with consignment auctions, not only consignment auctions, but on-site auctions, you have more types of merchandise of all kinds than you do in about anywhere else. It is like a department store. It's like a grocery store. So you might remember over the years, if you watched the show at all, we'll go to this slide, my auction mantra. You can sell more merchandise to better advantage in a shorter period of time at the auction than any other marketing form. So now, all of a sudden, the light bulb came on after all these years. I've used that line for so long with clients, with buyers, with sellers. I've got Bill's auction mantra revised. You can sell more merchandise in more categories to better advantage in a shorter period of time at auction than with any other auctioning format. So what we're going to do tonight, we have this extremely large, extremely interesting consignment auction coming up at the end of the month, and I'm going to flip through a lot of slides. If you tuned in the December episode, you saw a whole show on some of the vintage Disney collectibles. If you tuned into the January All That Stuff, you saw an entire show on the Thomas Eakins, the portrait that we have attributed to Thomas Eakins. And now we're going to go through it, and I'm going to show you some of the things that you can find in this particular consignment auction. Let's go to one more slide. So the auction is open for bidding right now. You can bid online or you can bid absentee. The way you bid absentee is by contacting me with your bids, and then we will have a staff member submit your bids online under your name in advance of the auction. Lot one begins closing on Sunday, February 26th at 7 p.m. That's a week from this coming Sunday. And we have two on-site previews. So all the bidding is online, but we always, you know, we've been doing our personal property online only for about 7 years now. But we always have live previews. We still do our real estate live with online bidding, but all of our personal property is done online only. So we have two on-site previews where you can come and look at the merchandise that is in the auction. The on-site preview location is 1251 Chestnut Street here in Reading, and we will be there Saturday, February the 25th from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m., and we will be there Sunday, February the 26th from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. That's the day that the auction closes, and then at 7 p.m. on Sunday the 26th, Lot 1 begins closing, and the lots will close in catalog order consecutively. If any lot receives a bid in the last 2 minutes, that lot will extend, but the other lots will keep closing. So first, here's the Thomas Eakins portrait. It's signed Thomas Eakins. It's dated 1904. It's consistent with his work at that time, where he was concentrating mostly on portraits. This is really a study, and I'm not going to take a lot of time with this because we have so many other items. Go back and check. You can go to the BCTV website, go to the archives, and look up the January 2023 show, which we called Thomas Eakins' Art Imitating Life, and you can see an entire one-hour show on the process that we employed for 5 years to determine to a great degree of possibility what attributed means to is that the preponderance of all evidence that we have been able to gather on this item suggests and states that this is by Thomas Eakins. However, there is an element, a small element of possibility that it is not. So that's what attributed means. That's the definition of attributed in the art world. You'll find several definitions, but that's the most common definition, and that's the one that we are using here. This is a 1904 portrait that we are attributing to Thomas Eakins. It is signed Eakins 1904. Check out that January show if you'd like to get an in-depth explanation of the process we use. Thomas Eakins, one of the two or three foremost American painters of the 19th century. Charles M. Russell, when we first got this was purchased in this out of the same attic about 35 years ago in a high-end area of Philadelphia. This was purchased out of the same attic. It's a Charles M. Russell Western scene. When we, you know, I was always puzzled about this one, so finally we deconstructed it. It does not show any indication of print marks, of printing, you know, of the matrix dots. They aren't really, weren't initially matrix dots in the lithograph process, but if you know anything about prints, you know when you look at a print, you can see the artifacts of the printing process when you examine it under magnification. This had none of that, so finally I deconstructed it. It is a Charles M. Russell scene. It is called When the Price of Horse Flesh is High. When we deconstructed, this is what we found on the back. It said proof set, water dash oil. So that kind of confirmed to us what we had been seeing, that we could not see any artifacts and remnants of the printing process. It can probably be one of two things. Either this is the proof that was done at the printing. Normally an artist's proof is the first number of prints run off of the press once the printing process has begun to make a print from an original work of art. This may be that, but it is more likely the work, the final work that was submitted by Charles M. Russell to be used as the template for a series of prints. One thing that's interesting, if you ever go look at the original painting, he did an original painting of this, you will see that it's polychrome. The sky is blue, not green like that. No, but at that era, in the early 1900s, oftentimes prints were being made in the printing process, and I'm losing some time here, but I'm going to tell you about this one. In the printing process, every color had to be run a different time. You ran all the blues first, then you ran the reds, and then you ran the yellows. And so if you had eight colors, you had to run that piece of paper through the press eight times to get the colors in the right place and to get all the colors. The original painting on canvas that Charles M. Russell did, The Price of Horse Flesh is High, or it may be The Price of Horse Flesh is Dear, was full polychrome. The sky was blue. But oftentimes in prints that were made at that time, they were made in what are called bichromes or trichromes. So basically they cut down the number of colors so that you only had to run it through the press one or two or three times. It made it cheaper, it cut down on the labor, and it made the print more affordable. This looks like a trichrome of that era, very, very similar to the prints you would have bought. I suspect it is probably the final proof that was submitted by Charles M. Russell. I can't tell you for certain. What I can show you is this. I can show you that it says on the back, proof set, water and oil, and it is not printed ink. And then the other thing that was very revealing is notice all the fingerprints around the edges in the green color, where someone has grabbed it around the edges with all the fingerprints. And if you look at the bottom right, you'll see the best on your screen, but it was all around there. So we know that there was some color tinting applied to the surface. But you will have to make up your own mind as to exactly what it is. I haven't been able to determine, but it does appear to be some type of original work of art. And I suspect it may have been what Charles M. Russell submitted to his publisher as the final work so that the person then engraving the copper plate would know exactly how he wanted it and they would know exactly what colors he wanted. All right, on the back of this painting, carved into the frame, or carved into the backboard really, was the following, a state of Mrs. A. Eakins, Chestnut Hill, Pennsylvania, Millers, New York, and it also had a foil sticker with an embossed Statue of Liberty over to the left. Once again, this painting was bought out of the same attic as the painting that is signed by Thomas Eakins and that we have attributed to Thomas Eakins. Henry Weinsheimer was a member of the New Hope School, 1879 to 1935, I believe were his birth death dates. We have three original oil on boards by Henry Weinsheimer, Great Landscapes. A lady named Charlotte Dennis, who was an artist, a mid-20th century artist in Somerville, New Jersey, and had connections to Pottstown. We have probably 20 of her works. They really have a nice character and quality and caliber to them. Let's go back to that slide so we can look at it a little bit. You notice the fall scene there. You notice the landscape and the townscape and another fall scene. Let me go back. If you go to the catalog, you're going to see about 20 of her works, and you're going to see some of them that have in their composition, not in their colors, have almost a Rockwell Kent style influence. You can see it a little bit in the bottom left landscape. It's slightly primitive, slightly mid-century. And then, of course, as you can see in the landscape, she had a very top left and the bottom right. You can see she also had a sophisticated, trained artist style. That's Charlotte Dennis. We have two interesting mid-20th century Cubist paintings. One is signed JDL. The other one is unsigned, but actually very well executed. This is an exceptional piece. This is a piece of Victorian hair work. If you know anything about the Victorian era, you know that they saved hair. Remember the hair receivers? You might have seen a hair receiver looks like a dresser jar, except it has a hole in the middle. What's that hole for? That's where they would brush the hair, and then they would put the hair in there. What would they do with the hair? They would make jewelry out of it, Victorian hair jewelry. This is probably the largest, most complex piece of Victorian hair work I've ever seen. It's about 30 inches high. It's about 22 inches wide. It's in a walnut oval shadow box type frame, and that entire composition there is made from human hair. So it's in some ways it's like the pressed flower artwork that we've seen here before on BCTV, except instead of being made from flowers, it's made from human hair. This came down through the consigner's family, and I suspect was made by her great grandmother. All right, now we've got a lot of great jewelry. Top there, 18K leopard with the rubies and diamonds and enamel. Below that, three Art Deco pieces, the two bracelets and the pin. Those are platinum, diamonds, and sapphires. And then the bottom right photo, you have a diamond solitaire set in platinum with a 14K white ring guard. All of this jewelry, you know, for several years, we have been helping the Geringer, Bernicker, Heinzson line of families that owned Roadside America dispose of assets this is some of the finest of the jewelry. We've had about four sales of the jewelry. This is some of the finest of the jewelry from that group of families. So you've got an 18K leopard pin on top with ruby eyes and diamond eyebrows and snout with enamel enamel accents. You've got a Art Deco platinum diamond and sapphire bracelet. Below that you have another platinum diamond and sapphire bracelet. You have a platinum diamond and sapphire pin, which is probably part of a demi parure with the bracelet. A demi parure being at least two pieces of jewelry that match: a bracelet, a pin, or a necklace and a bracelet, a necklace and a pin, a bracelet and earrings. And then in the bottom right there, you have a diamond solitaire with platinum and a 14K ring surround. Okay, on the left you have an 18K ram's head ring purchased at the Zelotis Jewelry in Athens, Greece. That was the jeweler that supplied Jacqueline Onassis with most of her jewelry after she married Aristotle Onassis and went to live in Greece. It comes with its original Zelotis suede presentation case. On the right, you have an 18K bird. That's 18K gold with gemstones for eyes, gemstones on the branch, and with polychrome enamel. It's just some outstanding jewelry. Top here, you have a 18K white gold mesh bracelet with a large light blue topaz. This one comes with a Cartier presentation case. It is not marked Cartier. I do not believe it to be Cartier. I can find no evidence of Cartier making a form like this, but it was sent to us in the Cartier case. It fits very nicely. It fits perfectly in the Cartier case, but the Cartier case is coming with it because that's the way it was consigned to us. Bottom left, you have a 14K diamond solitaire in a 14K yellow gold surround with diamonds. And on the right, you have a 14K yellow gold ring with a large emerald cut or cushion cut aquamarine. All right, gold. Lots and lots and lots of gold. We have probably five gold chains. You see examples of two of them on the left. And on the right there, you see a strand of 14 Mikimoto pearls. Mikimoto pearls. Mikimoto was the name of the gentleman who founded the company in the late 1800s. And he was actually the developer of cultured pearls. Mikimoto cultured pearls are really pretty much the top of the line because of their long heritage, 125 years of producing cultured pearls, and also because Mr. Mikimoto was the developer of the cultured pearl, and because they're of the highest cultured pearl qualities, these have great luminescence. Okay, there's five more examples of the gold, gold choker, gold bracelet. Top left, you have a gold chain with a small diamond set in a piece of gold. Bottom left, you have a gold 14K gold chain with a 14K gold nugget pendant. So lots and lots and lots of gold in this auction. This is our transition piece between the jewelry and the coins. This is a, what year is that? This is an 1853 $1 gold piece right there in the first earliest years of the gold coin in the United States, the U.S. minted gold coins. Interestingly enough, that 1853 date coincides nicely with the gold rush, the 1848 gold rush in California, and that began the minting of U.S. gold coins. Of course, gold had been discovered before. There was gold in northern Georgia, there was gold deposits in various places, but when they found the gold in Georgia was when the United States began minting to any significant number gold coins. This is a 14K gold ring with, you can see 10 diamonds there, and set into that is an 1853 $1 U.S. gold coin. Okay, this is, as I say, a statement piece. This is a $20 gold coin, a 1904 $20 gold coin with a diamond surround. All of those are diamonds, and the surround border is 14K. So it's a double eagle, what's known as a double eagle, 1904 U.S. gold coin with a diamond surround with about 25 diamonds, and the surround itself is 14K, as is the ring you see there where it can be. It's basically set to be a pendant. Now, one of the reasons I like to do this is severalfold. As I go through these, I'm able to tell you different things. So if you're listening, and you know, if you won't catch it all in one time, probably you may want to go back and watch it again. But I'm going to tell you little things about these pieces as they go along. As I see them, it brings up things that allows me to impart to you, because really part of this show is about explaining and promoting auctions. Part of this show is about explaining and promoting antiques and collectibles and helping you learn more about antiques and collectibles. And part of this show is helping you obtain usable knowledge. If you have any interest in antiques and collectibles, either as a hobby, as an avocation, or as a vocation. All right, this is an 1874 $5 gold piece. We have a significant number of gold coins in this auction. These are all $2.50 and $1 gold coins. We have an 1874 at the top left. Top right is a 1913 $2.50 piece. Bottom left is an 1849 $1 gold piece. You're getting right there at down to pretty close to the first issues of U.S. Mint gold coins. And you have an 1853 $1 gold piece, both of them in that very, very early era of gold coins. Okay, here's some piece dollars in high grade state. We have about 25 Morgan and piece dollars that are all in high grade state. So if you're interested in silver coins, you know, silver and gold both, but particularly silver is predicted this year to take a significant jump. It's at what would be considered historically over 20 years a relatively high price. Now, not as high as 2010, but some places are predicting that silver will hit $40 an ounce this year. I'm a little skeptical of that myself, but more than one supposedly a knowledgeable pundit is predicting it, but that's what prediction is about, right? It's kind of like predicting the weather. Okay, on the left-hand side, you have an 1838 U.S. half dollar, and on the right-hand side, you have an 1830 half dime. Back then, when a dime was worth even, you know, talk about a dime being worth something. Well, you know, a dime was worth something in 1920, but when you go back to 1830, a dime was really worth something, and they didn't call them nickels. One, they were made of silver. Although later on in the 1870s, we had a nickel and we had a silver nickel and we had a 3-cent nickel. But that's a story for another day, right? But they would call them half dimes. They didn't call them nickels, they called them half dimes, because a dime had real value. They were made of silver and they were known as half dimes. Okay, so now here's a little interesting story. This is a Mockins Mill, a 1778 Mockins Mill half penny. It was minted here in the colonies and is actually a counterfeit coin. But it's a different kind of counterfeit coin. What the revolutionaries were doing is they wanted to mess with the crown's currency system, right? So they took and printed here in the United States. They basically minted their own money. I said printed, I meant minted initially. They minted their own money and they made it just like the half penny, the George III half penny. Except in this case, they're known as Mockin Mills. And from the place they were minted in Mockin Mills, New York. And this is a colonial U.S. coin, a Mockin Mill half penny. All right, one of the earliest cents, when you get down to the very first cents, I think the first was 1793, it may have been 1794. That was the earliest official U.S. mint coin, you know. They were called large cents. This is a 1798. This is a 1798 draped bust cent. Anytime you get an 18th century U.S. cent, you're getting into some interesting coin territory. That one is not in a high condition state, but it's in, you know, a modest condition state for those coins when you normally find them. Okay. All right, how about some silver? On the top there, You have Linux porcelain insets. So that's a Demicast cup set. There's 12 of them. You have Linux porcelain insets with Gorham silver surrounds and silver saucers. Some pretty high-end stuff for the proper Victorian and Edwardian table. So that's the top one. Now, in the bottom set, you have a set of 12 also, and those are called Hanau silver. The maker is George Roth. Hanau was an area of Germany. It was like a free trade zone. And if you know anything about it, if you watch the silver show we've done a time or two, you know that silver always has purity marks. Silver, continental silver, British silver had purity marks because it was part of the taxation system. These do not have purity marks. Hanau silver can be anywhere from 200 fine to over 950 fine. I suspect these are probably about 800 fine. That's generally what George Roth was doing. George Roth was a known maker, but because it was a free trade zone, they didn't have to stamp it with the purity marks. But these are rather elaborate. They have busts of Louis XVI and Marie Antoinette on them. They were kind of a commemorative issues, probably of the fall of the Bourbon range and with the storming of the Bastille. So there's probably like a 100-year commemorative or something like that. Okay, more sterling silver there. In the top, you have Reed and Barton napkin rings. On the right-hand side, you have some Reed and Barton tableware. You have a sterling silver tray. And in the bottom left, you might say, well, what are those odd-shaped spoons? Are they teaspoons? No, they are known as mate straws. And they are used to drink mate, which is a South American tea, Central American tea, and in some areas of Spanish colonization. So they are mate straws. And when you are looking at that handle is hollow. So what you have, the set on the left is 800 silver. The set on the right of the mate straws is sterling silver, and those are known as mate straws. So the flatware on the right-hand side is Gorham. It's Gorham King's Queen pattern, and the tray is Robert Wallace and Sons. The sterling tray is Robert Wallace and Sons, and as I told you, the napkin rings are Reed and Barton. Gorham is one of the significant American makers of silver. Reed and Barton, both very prolific makers with good names. Wallace, less prolific, but known to be a desirable maker of sterling silver in the United States. So here's one of the most famous patterns. This is the Stief Rose pattern. The Stief Silver Company was really the most prominent American company to make repoussé silver. That is repoussé. Repoussé is the French word for pushed out, literally means pushed out. So repoussé silver was that heavy Baroque style silver where the pattern lifted off. It wasn't engraved, it actually had dimension, right? So Stief was bought out by Kirk. And then Kirk, they became Kirk Stief, and then they became Kirk Silver, who is one of the most desirable American sterling silver makers. When Kirk took over, they eventually turned this Stief Rose pattern into what they called Baltimore Rose with a slight alteration, still a repoussé pattern. But Stief Rose is probably one of the earliest sterling silver American patterns and is one of the most desirable. Remember, American silver did not start transitioning to sterling silver until around the 1850s, and it wasn't until around the 1860s and post-Civil War that sterling became the more popular and really the standard in the United States. It had been the standard much earlier in the British Commonwealth and in the continent. But prior to the Civil War, the most common silver in America was called coin silver because it was made from melted silver coins. Remember, sterling is a standard. Sterling means 925 1,000 silver. I'm going to keep giving you these tips as we go along because that's what it's all about. That's what this show is all about. Okay, we have another Reed and Barton sterling tray, and we have two Crown sterling compotes. The Crown sterling compotes are weighted. particularly as we got into the 20th century, we started having weighted silver. There were several reasons. One, it took less silver, but also the weighting made sure that things like candlesticks and compotes and things didn't turn over easily. You know, and of course that was really important with candlesticks, but it saved a lot of silver too. You didn't have to weight the base down with silver, and you didn't have to have hollow bases that made them less stable. Okay, here's an interesting set of silver, salt, and peppers, two different sizes. You've got two cut crystal, you've got a cut crystal set of salt and peppers in the back with sterling tops, but in the front bottom right, you have a really neat set there of what are known as salt cellars. This is these were very prominent before salt shakers became really prominent. And then you would pour the salt out, and you would put them in these little things called salt cellars. Generally, sometimes it's generally referred to salts. Those are salt cellars with sterling salt spoons as well. And there would be one sitting at every plate. Now, what was one of the reasons of having salt cellars? They had shakers. They could have just used shakers. Well, salt, particularly in from the first half of the 19th century and earlier, salt was a very expensive commodity and a very necessary commodity. So when you put the salt out in the cellars, it was very easy to then at the end of the meal have it poured back in and stored properly, as opposed to have it sitting around in salt shakers with open tops, you know, where it might cake, or, you know, it might become, its character might become distorted in some way. Here's a very nice British inkwell. First, you have a British cut crystal in kind of a quilted diamond pattern. British cut crystal at that time was equivalent to our American brilliant period cut glass. On the bottom right, you will see the hallmarks. And if you tuned into our silver shows, I helped you interpret British hallmarks there. Farthest on the left, it says J.G. and Son. That was John Grinwell and Son. Then you have the lion passant with the raised right paw. That's the mark for sterling. In the middle there, maybe if you've got a big screen, you can see it, is the date letter T. And I've showed you how those date letters were repeated every 26 years, starting in the 16 and early 1700s. This date letter equates to 1898, I believe it is. And then you have the anchor, which tells you that the silver was assayed and recorded for tax purposes in Birmingham, England. So this is a John Grisnell and Sons crystal inkwell with a sterling top. John Grisnell would have made the sterling top. He would have purchased the cut crystal base. We know that the date letter T for that cycle of the 26 years was 1898, and we know that it was made in Birmingham. That's an exceptional inkwell. All right, this is our transition into glass. On the left-hand side, you have an American brilliant period, which is abbreviated oftentimes as APB. Sometimes you'll see something that says APB vase. You wonder, what is APB? Is that who made it? No, that stands for American Brilliant Period. American Brilliant Period went from about 1880 to about 1910 or so. Some of the finest glass ever made in the United States. Left-hand side there, you have an American Brilliant Period cut glass powder jar. On the top there, you have two perfume bottles that are silver overlay. This is where a thin pattern of silver it is overlaid over cut crystal, and in the bottom you have two powder jars with gilt tops. That's a single little dresser jar lot. All right, we're transitioning to glass. The Pearpoint Company from New England was one of the finest of the American glassmakers. This is a cobalt Pearpoint console set. The pattern is English grape. What did they use console sets for? They had two purposes. Generally, they sat on a mantle, but they also sat in the table, and the bowl was the center bowl, and of course the two candles were on either side or placed appropriately on the table. But when you have that center bowl and two candlesticks, they're known as a console set. If it was a clock in the middle and two candlesticks, it would be known as a garniture set. A really beautiful piece of glass and one of the favorite colors, cobalt. As the light catches it, cobalt, that when you look at it without light on it for photography purposes, it has that deep cobalt blue. Once you apply light to it for purposes of photography, or once you use a flash to snap a picture of it, then you see the transparency of the cobalt more. All right, Stu Ben, another one of the fine from Stu Ben, Ohio, one of the fine American glass makers. This is a presentation bowl. It comes in its original box. It's not particularly old. It's probably 25 years old. It's in its original presentation box. It has the Stu Ben signature on the bottom. It has a great, wonderfully designed, modernistic three legs that it sits on. A very nice piece of glass, affordable piece of glass. Here you have depression glass. This is Hazel Atlas Modern Tone. We have two different lots. We have one service for six. I believe one of the cups may have a little chip on them. And then we have some extra pieces of Hazel Atlas Cobalt Modern Tone. That's depression glass. Left-hand side there, you have amber Venetian glass candlesticks. And on the right-hand side, now, you know, I've told you a lot about glass, and I've told you how clear glass, the market for clear glass over the years, whether it's early American press glass, EAPG, American Brilliant Period Cut Glass, later period cut glass, clear glass, the market for it has diminished greatly. But this is a rather unique vase. It was made by the Moser company, a famous glass company in Austria. It was designed by Joseph Hoffman, who was a famous designer. And this is a Joseph Hoffman Moser octagonal tapered vase that clearly depicts and kind of is quintessentially Art Moderne. In that mid-century when we were moving toward that 1940s, when we were moving toward and celebrating the industrialization, when the influence of the Bauhaus group out of Germany in the 1920s were beginning to spread all the way through all of the decorative arts. So that's a Moser Joseph Hoffman vase. And there you have two examples of American Brilliant Period cut glass. Now, quickly, that glass was hand-blown, and it was as smooth as a drinking glass when it came out. You know, both of those bowls were just as smooth as any regular old drinking glass with no ornamentation whatsoever. Every one of those facets was hand cut by an artisan into those bowls. So you start out with an entirely smooth piece of hand blown cut crystal, 24% lead or more, and then you literally hand cut just like you would a diamond, just like that was a huge diamond, except it's not as hard as a diamond. And it takes a lot of skill to hand cut every facet into American cut glass. The value of American cut glass has probably decreased 75% or so in the last 30 years. But it's still one of the two or three finest glasses ever produced in the United States. Both of those are American Brilliant Period cut glass. Around 1885 to 1910 is the American Brilliant Period. All right, music memorabilia, we've got it. Top photo there is 1956 Elvis Presley trading cards. Bottom right, you've got Elvis, an original bottle of Elvis Presley teddy bear perfume, full bottle with its original box. And on the bottom left, you have some Elvis bookends. You have a 1956 Cabaret magazine where the title, that one in yellow that you can maybe see, that's Jane Mansfield on the cover, by the way. The one guy is saying, How I Taught Jane, the one article is entitled How I Taught Jane Mansfield to Be Sexy, which is by a photographer who claims that he's the one that took poor old Jane, who was come up from Louisiana, and taught her how to be a Hollywood starlet. And then the next article title on the cover says, Who the Hell is Elvis Presley? So that was a 1956 magazine, just as Elvis was coming out. I guess eventually they figured out who the hell Elvis Presley was, right? All right, a 50th anniversary edition of the Beatles' Sgt. Pepper. It comes with four CDs. It comes with a lot of outtakes and tracks that did not make it onto the album. It comes with a whole lot of paper ephemera and things about the making of Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band. That was a 50th anniversary set from just a few years ago, and that one's still sealed in the box. Little Richard.
Whoa.
All right, so we have a photo, a black and white promo photo signed Little Richard as part of our music memorabilia. Jerry Lee, good killer, killer there. And we got a killer promo photo, we got some killer 45s, and we also have that Sun 45 with the B-side Breathless, and it is signed Jerry Lee Lewis. All right, David Bowie. Hey, you know, we're not just gonna stick there with the old guys. We got David Bowie. Lots of David Bowie ephemera here in this particular lot. There are two David Bowie lots. There's an Eagles, two vintage belt buckles, Eagle and Queen. We have a whole Queen lot of paper ephemera, including press passes and backstage passes that are part of the left-hand lot. And on the right-hand side, you have a battery-operated Freddie Mercury action figure. Now, if you tuned in to the December episode, you saw an entire show on the vintage Disney items that we have. You can go back once again. You can go to the BCTV website, and you can check out that whole one-hour episode. It also had to do with another collection that I sold maybe 10 years ago, a very high-end Disney vintage collectibles. These are moderately priced Disney vintage collectibles. Looking at the top row from left to right, you have a period issue Mary Poppins musical figurine. She's got the two spoonfuls, the tablespoon and the teaspoon for that two spoonful of sugar. You have a 1940s or so Mickey Mouse ceramic figure. You have in the middle there, very interesting, because you can see that was early Mickey Mouse, 1930. That's Mickey Mouse figurine in boxing gloves. You know, I can see more like Mighty Mickey Mouse there. Next to him, you have a cast iron, a little miniature cast iron flag holder from Mickey Mouse, red, white, and blue Mickey Mouse to hold the little flags, you know, the little tiny flags that are often used and for a variety of purposes and that we see a lot around around 4th of July. Top right photo is three bottles of, one bottle of Minnie perfume and two bottles of Mickey and Minnie perfume, full bottles. Bottom left, you see a Dakin, early 1960s, Dakin figurines, very collectible, of Mickey Mouse. Next to that, you have a vintage, retro, probably 1960s Mickey Mouse table lamp with printed characters, 1950s or so. Jiminy Cricket cup with lenticulated eyes. And what are lenticulated eyes? Well, they're also oftentimes referred to familiarly as googly eyes, so that his eyes appear to move as you move the cup, and as you move your hand in front of it, you can see Jiminy's eyes go back and forth. And then in the bottom right, we have an early Mickey Mouse commemorative cup. More Mickey Mouse. Top left, you have a Flasher Studios of California. That's probably early 40s, late 30s. There you have Thumper and his girlfriend with a salt and pepper. Bottom left, you have what's known as a Mickey Mouse or a Disney turnabout cookie jar. And that's because if you turn the head, it's Mickey Mouse on one side and the base too. It's Mickey Mouse on one side and it's Minnie Mouse on the other. So if you were to turn that around instead of seeing Mickey's head and body, you would see Minnie's head and body. They're known as turnabouts. All right, of the divided photos there to the right of the turnabout, you see some early Disney character glasses, much earlier than the ones you normally see from the 70s, the Pepsi series and stuff like that. You see a 1940s Cinderella planter, and then you see a Goldilocks and Snow White figurines from the 1940s. Stickers, I told you in the Disney show back in December, not just Disney stickers, but stickers. Every dog has its day in the antique and collectibles industry. Stickers are hot, folks. This is a whole group of vintage Disney stickers. All right, and here you have a set. They were called PALPHOT, P-A-L-P-H-O-T, I guess for PAL photos. Short for PAL photos. They were an Israeli company. There you have 13 postally unused Disney animation postcards from the 1970s, 80s, printed in Israel. Very nice if you're a postcard collector, if you're a Disney collector. They show scenes that combine Bambi and the Seven Dwarfs. So they're pretty nice as far as postcards go. All right, let's get into a little porcelain here. Top. You have seven tea bowls. What were tea bowls? Well, before teacups had handles And when it was still common to pour your tea out into the saucer to let it cool, you had tea bowls. And they looked like bowls, but they had a saucer, and they had tea served in them. Those are all Staffordshire transferware. When transferware came in the late 18th century to 19th century, instead of hand painting the porcelain, they were actually transferring it like a decal, brand new process. It allowed them to do these very, very ornate patterns, just like the cow you see in the cow creamer. That is a Staffordshire cow creamer from the 19th century, probably from the first half of the 19th century. Staffordshire was a district in England that was known for producing not only a lot of English porcelain, but was kind of the heart of the transferware area, the transferware porcelain that was produced in England in the 19th into the 20th century. And you know, many of those souvenir plates you see, like, you know, you see from the 1950s, many of those plates that you see here in Berks County, you know, the Zion Lutheran Church and the this, that, and the other in the courthouse that you see from all over the country, those are transferware. You know, many of them were made in, still made in Staffordshire in the 20th century, still being made in Staffordshire now, not quite as prolifically. But there you have English transferware, first half of the 19th century now on the tea bowls, and the creamer was still produced up into the 1880s or so. That one most likely, that blue on white transfer blue willow, is likely first half of the 19th century. Here you have, this is another form. This is a form of transferware with hand-painted accents added over it. This is Mason's ironstone. It's a small tureen, probably used for sauces, you know, like cheese sauces and things like that. If you go to the catalog, you'll see about six or seven pictures. This is an exceptional piece of the style is known as Gaudy Welsh. You had Gaudy Welsh and you had Gaudy Dutch. Gaudy Dutch was gaudier than Gaudy Welsh. Gaudy Welsh was produced in England and was generally produced in the Staffordshire district. But that's a wonderful Gaudy Welsh tureen, condiment tureen, sauce tureen. All right, here you have Royal Bonn clocks. These are mantel clocks. Royal Bonn was one of the finest producers of porcelain in Germany. So you have a Royal Bonn clock with its original key, original pendulum. The style of Royal Bonn clock, the pattern and the style was known as La Lorna. Lorna was a city in Germany. And the movement is produced by Ansonia. Ansonia was one of the finest clock makers in the United States out of Ansonia, Connecticut. So you have an Ansonia movement in a Royal Bonn mantle clock. All right, Royal Dalton, another one of this is 20th century English porcelain tableware. You might be familiar with Royal Dalton Toby mugs. You might be familiar with Royal Dalton figurines. But Royal Dalton made some very, very fine tableware, okay? And this pattern is called Old Colony. It's a very attractive pattern when you look at it up close. Once again, if you go to the catalog, you'll get some close-ups of the pattern itself. I believe we have a service of everything for six, and then we have some extra pieces in there as well. So that is Royal Dalton is one of the finer of the English porcelain makers. Nippon. This is a scenic Nippon vase. This is a scenic Nippon vase. That little story, I've told you this before, but you know, in 1891, the McKinley Tariff Act, Congress passed a rule that the country of origin must be clearly displayed on products imported into the United States. Well, of course, the Japanese referred to their country as Nippon and had referred to it as Nippon since about the 9th century. Okay, in 1915, Congress said, okay, it can't just have the country of origin, it has to say made in, okay? In 1921, Congress said, you know what? We're tired of this stuff coming in writing that we can't understand. And we wanted everything anglicized. So in 1921, you could no longer have the word Nippon. You could no longer have the word made in Nippon. You had to have the word made in Japan. And Japan had to be referred to as Nippon because that was what they were referred to in the Western world, and that was the anglicized word for Japan, the anglicized name for Japan. So these are a Noritake, which is probably one of the finer and better known of the mass producers of Japanese porcelain. There was a lot of fine Japanese porcelain at the time. You know, Japan made great porcelain. They made cheap stuff to sell to us, and they kept the best stuff for themselves. But as far as mass-produced porcelain went, Nippon porcelain was a really pretty good quality porcelain. These are Noritake, marked Noritake Nippon. You know that for the most part, unless they were purchased over there and brought over here, possible, but not likely. They were made before 1950. They were made between 1891 and 1915. They are scenic vases with heavy gold overlay on cobalt accents. Very nice, and a very nice form. Okay, how about some money? Here's some original CSA, Confederate States of America currency, right? A lot of CSA currency out there, particularly around 1960, 1965, around the centennial of the Civil War. You got a lot of reproductions. You had some reproductions early in the 20th century. One of the ways that you can tell original, there's several ways you can tell original Confederate currency, but if they're not pen signed, if they're not signed by hand with a pen, then they're not original Confederate currency. Also, another thing is the Confederacy did not have a lot of access to paper made from papyrus or made from pulp. They were using rice paper because they grew rice. Rice paper is great to do art on, but it doesn't have the durability. So a lot of Confederate currency, unless it was uncirculated or kept somewhere and never used, will show some significant wear. Here we have, let me find my little notes on this so I can tell you which years they are. This is an example of some of the currency. Top left, you have a 1966 series $100 red seal. Red seal were banknotes. Green seals are Federal Reserve notes. Doesn't make a lot of difference unless you're a currency collector. But we have a 1966 $100 bill red seal. That's a federal banknote or a bank, what's known as a banknote. On the top right, we have a $5 1928 series Federal Reserve note. Notice that has the green seal. That is in uncirculated condition or near uncirculated condition, AU to uncirculated. Bottom left, we have a 1922 series $10 gold certificates. You might be familiar with silver certificates that say pay on demand to the bearer $1 worth of silver, which you can't get anymore, but you could up until they quit making printing them. But this was a $10 gold certificate. It's in rough shape, but they're pretty rare notes. And that meant that at that time in 1922 and in the 22 series, if you took that note, you could get $10 worth of gold for it. Okay, in the bottom right is an almost uncirculated AU $20 1934 series Federal Reserve note, okay? All right. I love this little pack of cards. Now we're going to get into some papers. This is oddities. We're finishing out here with some oddities here. Let me see how many I've got to go so I can, so we can take a little time here. I can't believe we did it. All right, this is a Chesapeake and Ohio Railroad playing cards. So back in the heyday of the railroad, you'd take a long trip and you could get, and maybe even were given as in complimentary fashion, a set of playing cards. This is a double set of playing cards, okay? On the left, the left-hand deck, the black deck with the black ground and the cat, that cat is named Chessie. And it also lets you know underneath the motto reads, Chessie, Peek's old man. And on the right, the kitten sleeping there, tucked into the blanket with her head on the pillow, that's Peek. And then on the right-hand side, you see the original box there, right? And it says, sleep like a kitten. Chesapeake and Ohio Railroad, okay? Now, the Peek set of cards are still sealed in the wrapper, the cellophane wrapper. The Chessie set of cards has been opened. They both have 54 cards, and then that means they're a full deck with two jokers. And if you know somebody that collects railroad or if you're into ephemera, that's a neat piece of ephemera to have. Uh-oh. The most successful bike that Schwinn ever produced was the Stingray. This is a 1971 unrestored Stingray bike. I believe 64 was the first year. They produced them until 1983 or 84. Why did they go out? Well, styles change, right? And all of a sudden, all the kids wanted BMX bikes. So this was the most successful bike. Schwinn's been making bikes for a long time and still makes them. This, the Stingray, was the most successful bike Schwinn ever produced. It has the high handles, it has the banana seat, it has the sissy bar on the back. It's been used and it's been rode. It's in unrestored condition, but people love them. This is an interesting one. This is a bank teller's cage. This is the grill. For a bank teller or any type of place where they were exchanging money and things like that. It is a bronze patina. It's a really great piece. You know, about four or five months ago, we did industrial artifacts. This is a great example of the art and design and form in industrial artifacts. Okay, this is a World War II era SS German uniform coat. They're referred to as tunics, T-U-N-I-C, okay? Oftentimes these were bought back. They are sometimes altered. Sometimes they have replacements. It looks like these have the original buttons, the original pins and things like that. And it looks like because they have the line sleeves, which you can't see in this, but you can see if you go to the catalog, it looks like it was probably an officer's tunic. May have been altered at some time. A lot of them were, but it is a World War II era. The body of it is World War II. I think it probably all is, to tell you the truth. Okay, how about a vintage Coca-Cola cooler radio, AM/FM radio cassette cooler, Coca-Cola mint in the box. It's about 25 or 30 years old. Still got the original plastic on it. Never been used. Or a Lemaire set of antique opera glasses with mother of pearl and a bronze patina on the brass frame and wheel. So, variety is the spice of life. Where are you going to find Confederate currency and U.S. currency and China and porcelain and glass and Disney and gold coins and paintings and jewelry all in one place? Well, it's at the supermarket, the auction supermarket. Once again, that's the winter 2023 consignment auction, online absentee bidding. The catalog's open for bidding right now. Lot 1 begins closing Sunday, February 26th, 7 p.m. We have two live on-site previews a week from this coming weekend at 1251 Chestnut Street, Saturday the 25th of February, 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. Sunday the 26th of February, 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. We hope to see you there. If you have any questions, you can either go to our website, www.auctionhouse.com. You can email me, bill@auctionhouse.com. You can call me. Or you can just visit us on Facebook at the Renaissance Auction Group. Now, for last but not least, I want to thank you so much for watching. But I have to say to you, if you can flip back to me here, I have to say to you that we appreciate you supporting Burst Community Television. You can go to the website, you can make a one-time donation, you can make a recurring donation. And just remember, Burst Community Television is the only multimedia platform that brings you shows about the things you care about, the places you love, by the people you know. The places you love, the things you care about, by the people you know. That's Berks Community Television, BCTV, Berks County's voice to the world. Thanks for tuning in. Hope you'll take advantage and participate in the auction. At least come down and check the stuff out there at 1251 Chestnut Street. Thanks so much for watching. We'll see you next month.
All That Stuff on BCTV is supported by the Renaissance Auction Group.